So I guess everything I'm going to say is pretty much a joint work with Jim Anderson. And so exactly what I'm going to talk about is a KD graph and measures on KD graph. All right, just give you a motivation of the things that we're interested in. So let me just, so the problem, is, can one always uniformize closed Riemann surface by a classical Schottky group? So that's pretty much the motivation of what we're trying to do here. So basically, let me just this what I did. So basically, if this is a Schottky space, so what we have is a Schottky cover of the moduli space, and now there is a subspace which I call a classical Schottky group. Okay, and this is a infinite cover, and this is universal and universal cover, and this is infinite cover, and so this actually is coming by, given by free group, which is symplectic morphism. But so the particular thing that we're interested in is, we want to show that's actually not empty. That's pretty much the problem that we're trying to decide. So the way we're going to do this is look at the Handlebody. Tetramer space to the Schottky space. That's mapping from, remember we did that last time? Yeah, but if you forgot, that's okay, because we're not going to address this today. So anyway, this is a subgroup of moduli, mapping class group, which is an infinite index a subgroup, which is given by this symplectic morphism. Remember we did that last time? That's okay, because we're not going to spend like half an hour and redo this stuff. So so we have what's called a Handlebody, and which is given by this. And now the question is, All right, so that's so we want a geometric criterion. Okay. So that's the thing we want to. So pretty much we want to ask why is this in this space. Recall that is giving us a quasi convex co-compact. Okay, so Schottky group, you can take as a definition, if you like, as a quasi-convex co-compact representation of a free group of rank k. That's a rank k Schottky group in PSL2C. and so just one thing is that we did that last time too, so I'm not gonna like. So this is a quasi isometry. So you take the definition of quasi compact representation if you have a Cayley graph which is quasi asymmetric to the orbit. So this is orbit map. Orbit map. Okay. I can use the other side of the board too, right? All right. So that's now one thing that we can look at it geometrically is since this is a convex co-compact, I guess we can look at the convex core of it, and so the we can, for instance, ask. The convex Hall entropy, and see that will give some kind of way of identifying when we have a group which is in a classical Schottky space. So and by the way, just for the people that don't know anything about Schottky group is that the convex hull, well, the convex core of it is actually a co-compact. It is compact. So the convex hull, I'll just, so say take this representation, I'll just put a gamma here. And we can look at the convex hull, which we know that is compact. This is compact. And we can look at the convex hull entropy. So convex hull entropy, because it's compact, so we can define this convex hull entropy just like we do for the volume entropy, right? So so that's the convex hull entropy, which is similarly defined for volume entropy if you have a compact manifold. So this one here, the convex hull entropy, for instance, we can claim that, for instance, by the way, this is rank K, right? Good.
Sorry, what's that?
What is it? Yeah, volume. Sorry about that.
Oh, volume,
yeah. Yes. Yeah. Is that better? Okay. All right. So and the comp. See if there exists. A positive number such that so we can have a lemma like this. For instance, it just says that, okay, if I know, for instance, my handle body do not have much of entropy in the convex hull, then I can say that actually it is uniformized by a classical Schottky group. So that's one geometric way of telling when you have a handle body that can be uniformized by a classical Schottky group, okay? So that's, but for the problem,
the number generators.
Yeah, C is independent of number generator. Yes, it is. But the problem that we have here is we need a little more direct geometric criteria. The fact that things we're dealing with Riemann surface rather than the handlebody directly, so which means that we have to somehow from the conformal infinity and pull up information data back to, say, for instance, the convex boundary of the hull, which is also a surface, for instance. So we need a little more, but this list show you that we're dealing with something that, for instance, do not have much of entropy inside the convex core. All right, so let's look at more geometrically. Condition on the handlebody. All right, we know it's a free group, so gamma is free group, right? So I'll take, for instance, so I'll let lambda be a generating set, and now I'll write S for the symmetric generating set, okay? And so the Cayley graph is with respect to a symmetric generating set. And I'll define W be a collection of all generating set. So a collection of omegas of omega. And so take a point in the hyperbolic space, I'll define M omega x within the minimum a displacement, or define J gamma x to be anyway. I'll move All right, so I guess a more geometric way of look at a criterion will be something like this. So this will be a geometric way of look at it. And for instance, you have injector radius if it's greater than that. So I'll discuss one ingredient. Of the idea of this. So the ingredient that is a type of measure decomposition. The idea that I'm gonna discuss mainly today is one ingredient for instance, Schoen lemma is what's called a measure decomposition. Now, this type of measure decomposition originally, Mark Culler and Peter Shalen did that. For when you have a limit set which is the unit sphere and the Hausdorff dimension of 2, which decomposes the area measure on it. This depends on what's called a paradoxical decomposition of a free group. So that's the idea. Now what I'm going to do is a little different decomposition, but the idea is pretty much the same, which is a paradoxical decomposition. now I'm gonna for our purpose, I'm gonna do it for like on a KD graph. What they use for? They show that. Well, they want to show a log 2 theorem for volume estimate. So they have a convex and they have a two generator free subgroup of a co-compact group, and they want to find some kind of a tubular neighborhood which they have a volume, a lower bound on volume estimate of the manifold. That's what they use for. Yeah, hyperbolic. Yeah, that's right. I mean, right, exactly. Yeah, you just find a tubular neighborhood, exactly. All right. But that's we don't need that here. So we're gonna do it. So before I can do that, let me just recall a few facts. Which for the KD graph. And by the way, I use for a Cayley graph with generating S, a symmetric gen. So I'll just recall a few facts on this. And hyperbolic means satisfies the delta thin triangle stuff, and finitely generated gamma with general set omega. So we say that the Cayley graph with word metric is delta hyperbolic according to this first definition here. So that's we call the gamma is hyperbolic if the Cayley graph with the word metric is delta hyperbolic. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's true. Yeah. All right. And the most obvious thing is that is quasi-isometric for any other generating set. So I'm gonna from now just ignore the generating set and just write a Cayley graph of F. And the thing I'm gonna interested in is the boundary of this Cayley graph. So I'll use this notation for the boundary of the Cayley graph. Now the boundary well, I already know what boundary looks like here. So we can use rays, which is infinite ray, and this ray here is equivalent if the distances are bounded, right? And you can also use what's called a sequence of points, which with the lower limit of Grumov products. S goes to infinity, which here is the Grumov product, if you guys remember this. Right, so it's just this distance here. So that's the boundary we're gonna be working on. see. It topologizes, and the topology is giving us a base, which is collection of bases. It's given by Hmm. Okay, so that's pretty trivial stuff. So you topologize according, this is a Gromov product. And so you topologize according to the distance given by the Gromov product, which is just 2 points here. All right. So now we have topology, and then what we also have is the visual metric. Is there a question? Okay. So there is actually exists some kind of metric on it, which we call a visual metric. So this is given by, depends on the parameter epsilon. Okay, so the visual metric on the boundary, okay, for is of magnitude of this constant multiple of that. Okay, so it's, but it depends on the parameter. If you change the parameter, so one thing is that there always exists a metric looks like this, okay? So there always exists such a measure. So there always exists some epsilon that gives you m with a center, a base point z. And so now if you change epsilon, you just get, so changing epsilon, you just get, what is it? Holder continuity, holder equivalency, sorry. And if you change base point, you get Lipschitz. Did I spell that right? Yeah. All right, so we have a metric on the boundary now. Called a Boltzmann function. All right, so a Boltzmann function So you have a Boltzmann function. This is a function, what is more like a difference of two Boltzmann functions. And so we take that as a definition of Boltzmann function. And gamma.
WNs are
yeah, that's right. That's right, yeah. That's right, yeah. So we take all possible rays that go going to that data here. Act on the visual metric. So the group acts by right left multiplication on a KD graph, and it changes the visual metric by producing a factor of Boosman function. Okay, that's pretty straightforward standard stuff.
What's the zeta there? D zeta of epsilon in an exponent.
Oh, epsilon. Sorry.
Epsilon b.
B. Theta is let's see. I think I see this. Let's see, what is it? Let's see. Produce.
And I guess what's x and y for that?
Well, x and y is a point on the. Right, yeah. Sorry about that. Yeah, that's right. I was a little confused on that. Yeah, sorry about that. Yeah, sorry. Oh, gamma. Yeah, that's better. Sure. That better?
What's
Z? You mean here? You mean Z?
It's
this one here.
Is that
the zeta? Yeah, it is zeta.
So.
That's. Well, that's what is it? Well, that's the. what is it? Let's see. I think. Did I? Oh, sorry about that. Oh, yeah. This is on.
Okay.
Let's see. What did I? Yeah, that's the base point. We're taking right. So the Boosman function. See the one. Hold on a second. Let's see. Well, see. No, I mean, okay, so. Here, zeta here, I'm picking a zeta which is fixed on the boundary, which is a base point depends on, the Boosman function depends on you pick a point on the boundary. So this zeta here is fixed for this Boosman function. Okay, so that's this theta right here, which I fixed. So there exists. So I take a point here on a boundary. And I define a Boosman function like this, okay, and then my visual metric will change by a factor of this. This is my definition of Boosman function. So there's nothing wrong with it. Okay.
But if I change zeta on the right hand side, the left hand side stays the same. If you change like theta, it'd be a fixed point again or something.
No. This z here will asymptotic goes to the z, to theta here.
By thought Z was your base point.
That's a base point. Yeah, Z is a base point. So this is over here. That's my base point on the boundary, which I define to be the Boltzmann function, which is the rate connecting this to that point here. But I mean that's nothing wrong with that. So I'll write this. So there's a result due to Cornet. Let's see. All right, so his result tells you that, first of all, we have what's pretty much analogous to...
Excuse me.
Yes, go ahead.
This whole discussion was about the Cayley law.
Right.
You need to relate that, I assume, to its action on the hyperbolic three space, right?
Yes.
We're not just looking at a free group.
Right.
So where's the connection? Is that what you're doing now?
Yeah, I'm going to come to it. Yeah.
D gamma
is what's pretty much called a Hausdorff dimension.
The limits.
Right.
Okay. That depends on the action. You've introduced this whole boundary of the tree for some reason.
Right. Yeah, that's right, yeah. So what we have is that, so I'll take point O, and what we have is a Hausdorff measure. And this Hausdorff measure has precisely this dimension here, and this is a quasi-conformal measure. All right, so now this, you recognize this is called a Patterson-Sullivan measure. All right, so this is exactly the measure that we're gonna decompose, pretty much. Where?
D gamma, the definition of D gamma is equal to 1 over something, limit, 1 over R log.
Log of...
so what's the constant?
The coefficient.
The coefficient? What's the coefficient?
Is it 1 over epsilon, 1 over 2, what is it?
No, 1 over epsilon.
So how does epsilon
epsilon? Epsilon, remember that was the definition that we get from the visual metric? That's the parameter for the visual metric. That's defined through the visual metric.
The gamma of x is the orbit of x at some point in time law space. Is that the Cayley graph?
This is what's very confusing.
This is in Cayley graph. Everything is in Cayley graph.
So how can you get the Patterson measure on the Cayley graph without looking at the action on a hyperbolic?
No, I mean, this is a hyperbolic. This is dealing with a word metric.
But somewhere you have to, it's in the action, it's not, the Cayley graph is,
it is abstract, yeah, with work metric, but it's hyperbolic.
We can't pick up the Patterson-Sullivan by itself.
What do you
Patterson
mean?
Patterson-Sullivan has to do with
it's Patterson-Sullivan for the Cayley graph.
Oh,
Yeah, I mean,
this is all for the Cayley.
Yes.
And its boundary.
Okay. Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
So.
I mean.
To do with anything yet.
It has everything to do.
Free group can't be that interesting. By itself. There's a guy who works at the
frequency,
that's probably
right. All right.
Until it acts, it's not interesting.
Well, it's interesting enough that you have some kind of, which
you
is...
You can do a harmonic analysis on it.
Yeah. So... Let me just write this conformal factor as No, they don't have that. You mean Patterson Solomon?
They have an eigenfunction, the conformal density, but it is integral. I don't know if it is a conformal, but it's quite similar.
Okay.
Which satisfies. Integral around the boundary of the Poisson kernel.
Mm-hmm.
Into the function in the interior. That's Solomon. Well, that's Patterson.
Really?
Uh,
Well, this is a decomposition according to the generators. Okay, so I'm not sure exactly what patterns the solvent have, but this is a decomposition. So we construct a family of measures according to the generators and probability measures, and that probability measures will give you some kind of identity over the boundaries, which is so this, yeah, this is exactly the decomposition I was trying to tell you about. Yeah, that's right. This is the decomposition measure. So yeah, so this gives us a way of getting the a geometric criterion that we want from generating sets of a group, which is something.
I'm confused. Which part is on the tree? Which part is hyperbolic?
This is on a tree, hyperbolic. Sorry.
It's a purely,
yeah, that's right.
Of a tree.
That's right. Exactly. Right. Right. This is a pretty much decomposes the quasi-conformal measure of the Cayley graph on the boundary. Yeah. I mean.
Maybe I'm confused. Wasn't your condition on the first theorem was about the Hausdorff dimension?
Right. The convex.
The first thing that you call the lemma.
Yeah, that's except I put
C
in a convex hull.
If you're less than that, then you Schottky.
Right.
You're trying to extend that with some, to make it more general. That's my understanding.
No, I'm not trying to extend that. No, not. I mean, that's pretty much general that you can do pretty for a finite Kleinian group. There's not much I can extend that. What I'm trying to do is, if you look at it, is that I want to extract information on a generating set, which is geometric condition. I want, like, say, like how the curves, the length of the curve of the handle body reflects when you have a classical Schottky group. Okay, so that's the geometric criterion that you want, because eventually what you want to do is that. On a Riemann sphere, when you have curves on a Riemann sphere, if you want to take a look at all those curves on a Riemann sphere, you want to find markings on a Riemann sphere that will give you a corresponding gross marking in a handle body. That's exactly the condition. So you look at through markings and you find those symplectic orbits on those markings, and you find which one that corresponds the Schottky group. That's the condition that that you want to look at it. That's the thing. I mean, so that's. That's not extending anything of Hausdorff dimension, right? I mean, I'll give you a very, very a brief, I'll put it over here. All right. So I mean, the idea. I'll just give you a extremely rough idea, and so pretty much what you have is that. So if we write a Cayley graph. Okay, so this is extremely rough. So So nothing is extremely with initial letter. And then there exists measures for each and so it pretty much just decomposes the measure according to orbits, okay? And the support of this family, so you just, I mean, it's nothing really. And then after you get a construct family of measure, and this family has particular set of properties. Okay. And then this set at a particular point so we take us some of that measure that give you a decomposition of the Patterson solver measure at the point at the base point O. And we take our measures and then this set of measure will satisfy the property. So this is extremely rough idea. And so what you do is that you decompose your KD graph, and then you construct family of gamma invariant measures along the different parts of the KD graph, which is supported with this decomposition set. And then use a very very nice trick that it is a paradoxical in term of decomposition. And so you can produce a two set of family of probability measures with the property that you want. That's
Is humongous. It's some compact group that X, I mean,
Yeah.
The boundary is homogeneous with respect to that action, so it should be uniform with respect to that measure, and there should be explicit formulas.
Explicit in term of what?
Well, for each cone type, you can get some fraction of the.
Yeah, you might, yeah. Well, you probably can put some more detail, I guess, into it. Yeah. That's right. Any questions? I mean, that's one ingredient to prove that. Because then you have for hyperbolic space that you have a precise estimate, like INSEE, for instance, I can actually compute these integrations, and so for hyperbolic space, and then I can get estimate like that. For instance, I know the precise formula for the Poisson kernel. Okay, so that's why I can get actual estimate. That's using precise formula for the Poisson kernel.
Mm-hmm. What is exactly?
What is it?
So you have a condition on gamma,
right.
Which is saying roughly what, which ensures that it shows.
Right.
That's now those two things. What is the roughly? What's the condition on what?
Condition on the generating set.
And what kind of things about the generating set?
It just says that if you all your generating sets have enough displacement, it should be classical. And this enough is precise estimate. And I can actually estimate that precisely because you need that particular estimate. Because
and that does not generalize your first theorem.
No, of course not. I mean, there's what's to generalize my first theorem? There's not much.
First theorem was a sufficient condition. This is another sufficient condition.
Well, I mean, that condition it depends on like for instance the entropy, which is hard to put that.
These displacements allow you to estimate the entropy.
Right, but I mean it's hard to visualize or try to extract a marking condition on the Riemann surface that produces particular entropy. That's the thing. But I can produce the markings that will give me the curves. Yeah, that's right. Any questions?